Hey everyone. Just a few days ago, Christians all over the world celebrated Palm Sunday, the day that commemorates the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, riding on a donkey, a symbol of peace, greeted by cheering crowds of thousands waving palm branches. The crowds before him and behind him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." They recognized him as the Messiah that day. They were literally quoting an acknowledged prophecy of the Christ from Psalm 118. Palm Sunday is the first day of Holy Week or Passion Week, Jesus' final days on earth. And in a few more days, Christians everywhere will be celebrating Easter or Resurrection Day. So, Palm Sunday, thousands are celebrating the arrival of their Messiah, and 5 days later, he's hanging on a cross. And that's where this video is going. Before Resurrection Day comes Good Friday. And I'm going to keep it real. I never understood why anyone would call that day Good Friday. Obviously, I know the significance of Good Friday and the hope that Christians all over the world now have because of Jesus' sacrifice. But to me, I always thought it should have been called something else, something more realistic, I guess realistic, like Dark Friday, Black Friday. Like that should have been the original Black Friday. And my entire life, I've always thought that. But then I heard the Phil Wickham song, "Sunday is Coming." And in it, he sings, "Friday's good, 'cause Sunday is coming." And though that particular Friday most definitely was good for us, Friday was not good for Jesus. It was brutal. It was literally the worst day of his life. But he endured it for us. I was pretty sick over this last weekend and not able to do much of anything except lay around. So I took that time to catch up on my usual Easter movies. And one of my favorites is The Robe, a movie from 1953 and its sequel, Demetrius and the Gladiators. I watched Black Easter, which used to be called Assassin 33 AD. And that's sort of a different movie. One you would either love or hate. It's a go back in time and try to kill Jesus before he dies on the cross so Christianity never becomes a thing kind of a movie. And I watched The Passion. I watch that movie at least once a year, but honestly, there are parts that I can't view. I have to fast forward through them. It's too brutal, but to me, it's necessary. The visual is a necessary reminder for me because what we see in some churches and in pictures of Jesus hanging on the cross, it's quiet. He's pale. His eyes are closed. He's peaceful. But the cross was anything but peaceful. Weeks and weeks ago, I decided I was going to do an Easter video, but after watching The Passion, I decided instead to do one specifically about Good Friday. I wanted to do a video that conveyed the reality, the brutality of that day, something that would make people really understand and think what Jesus went through, like the movie The Passion does for me. I didn't know exactly how I was going to do it, but then I remembered a couple years ago, I had watched a video of a trauma surgeon discussing pretty much every aspect of the crucifixion. And so today, I'm going to share that video in sections, along with a demonstration within that video of a Roman flogging by Dr. Greg Veman, and as well as some information by Stephen Miller, who is an author that specializes in Bible-related projects. And all the links will be in the description below. But first, here's Dr. David Acuna discussing Good Friday and the night leading up to it from a medical perspective.
Yeah, I believe that Christ's suffering and the demonstration of the kind of physiologic stress that his human body was under is manifested in the Garden of Gethsemane, where it's described that he was sweating blood. And there is a well-documented medical condition in which patients who are under tremendous amount of emotional stress and physiological stress can, in fact, sweat blood because little blood vessels within the glands burst and then the blood is expressed. The scourge involved the use of a short whip with pieces of typically metal, sometimes bone, sometimes pieces of porcelain wrapped in these leather straps, which is then utilized to come across typically the back, the shoulders, the legs of the victim. And the first few passes across a particular body part would tear through the skin, the fat, but eventually, once the outer layers were torn away, it would start getting in the muscle and the tendon. And of course, along the way, you're ripping through all the blood vessels that supply all those tissues. And so you're losing blood the whole time.
And remember that this is cardboard. Cardboard is much thicker than skin.
The plant that was described actually had a very long thorn, not the little thorns that we would think from a rose bush. These were thorns that were typically 1.5 to 2 inches in length. The scalp is one of the most vascular portions of our bodies. It had a huge blood supply up there. So then having those thorns shoved down into the, down onto the bony plate would have gone through all the scalp, which in and of itself would have created a huge amount of blood loss. I've seen people actually bleed to death from just a scalp injury. So it's not a small injury to have, dozens of these things shoved into your scalp. And so that would have caused more blood loss. Typically when a victim has to carry the cross, what has been described in the literature, in actual Roman literature, is they carry the crossbar. And the crossbar was estimated to weigh about 110 pounds. Anatomically, we consider the wrists as part of the hand. And so with the placement of the nails between the radius and the ulna, at that position, It still fits the definition of being in the hand, and it's in a position in which the nail won't rip out, which you have to have a solid point of fixation. Another interesting point about the placement of that is the median nerve goes right straight through that particular portion of the wrist, and so there would have been either destruction of the nerve or impingement of the nerve that would have created a tremendous amount of pain. So that every time you try to take a breath, it'd be agonizing. You'd be pushing down on spiked feet, which of course hurt, and then you'd be hanging on spiked arms. And so you alternate from excruciating pain to excruciating pain every time you take a breath. So even if he survives the actual crucifixion, he would have had to survive what I believe to be a lethal injury from the spear to find out whether he was alive or not. What's described is the loss of water and blood, and that would entail either either a pleural effusion or pericardial effusion, and the blood would have come from either pulmonary artery, pulmonary vein, the aorta or vena cava, or the heart itself. None of those injuries, unless you're treated immediately by a trauma surgeon like myself, with all the advanced equipment that we have, would be survivable after even a few minutes.
I'm profoundly impacted by it. Because I realized that the price that he paid was something I would never be willing to do for probably anybody. It's very difficult for me to even sing songs about the cross, even in worship. Because I truly do understand what he paid. The price that he paid.
I don't know about you, but the first verse I thought of after listening to Dr. Acuna was John 15:13. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. Could you do what Jesus did for one of your friends, or even a loved one? Or to be more accurate, could you or would you do what Jesus did for your worst enemy, for the most evil and wicked person you can even think of? Paul writes in Romans 5:7-8, for scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Yet perhaps for a good man, someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Guys, other than Jesus, there has never been, nor will there ever be, a love like that. And regarding Roman crucifixion, Stephen Miller says, the Romans crucified people they thought threatened the Roman way of life to send a message. Don't mess with Rome. Crucifixion wasn't just a slow and painful way to die. It was reserved for the worst offenders. The Bible tells us that the Romans stripped Jesus, they spit on him, and Pilate ordered Jesus to be flogged. And then, afterward, according to John 19:2, the soldiers twisted a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put on him a purple robe. But accounts of Jesus' death and Roman crucifixions were not just recorded in the Bible. According to Josephus, a Roman citizen and Jewish historian, there was a wise man called Jesus, a good person who could work wonders. He attracted many followers, Jews and non-Jews. Pilate, at the request of our Jewish leaders, sentenced him to death by crucifixion. He was whipped until his bones showed. Tacitus, a Roman historian and politician, wrote, Nero blamed the fire that destroyed much of Rome on a group of people he found so disgusting that he ordered them tortured in horrifying ways. They were Christians. They got their name from Christus, a man who suffered the ultimate penalty at the hands of a procurator, Pontius Pilate, when Tiberius was emperor of Rome. When I watch the Passion or read the biblical accounts of what they did to Jesus, when I think of the physical pain and humiliation that he endured for me, I tend to go into a mental Simon Peter mode, if you know what I mean. I feel a lot of anger toward the religious leaders and Romans. I feel probably a lot like James and John felt when the Samaritan village rejected Jesus in Luke chapter 9. And they were so angry, they asked Jesus if he wanted them to command fire from heaven to come down and consume those people. Of note, Jesus didn't say, "Aw, you guys and your anger is so adorable." He scolded them harshly and said, "You do not know what manner of spirit you are of. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them." So I'm aware of how sinful my feelings are. I'm very aware. And I've always had a problem with this ultra over-the-top protectiveness over anyone that I love, as my husband and children would probably tell you. But the reality is, it was my sin that put Jesus on that cross as well. He died for me. He suffered so I wouldn't have to. And it wasn't just physical suffering. The moment the sins of the world were placed on him, I believe Jesus experienced for the first time the feeling of a true separation from his heavenly Father. And some might disagree with me on that, but in Isaiah 59:2, we read, "Your iniquities have separated you from God, and your sins have hidden his face from you." God did not forsake his Son, but God is holy, and he does not tolerate sin. It was because of our sin that God hid his face or turned his face from his Son just for a moment. Now, to be clear, Jesus never sinned, but our sins were on him when he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" He felt separated. He was perfect and without sin, never did anything wrong, but he took our punishment and he felt that separation. And after they did what they did to him, as he hung on the cross, looking down at the ones who turned him over to the Romans, the ones who beat him, spit on him, and mocked him, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." Can you even imagine that attitude? Can you comprehend that kind of love? And the awesome thing is, that love is for you. That love is for all of us. John 3:16 tells us, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." We are not promised tomorrow. We're not even promised 5 minutes from now. Our lives are a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. So over these next days, I want to encourage each of you to spend time meditating on what the sinless Son of God endured for you. And if you haven't yet made a decision to follow him, I hope you do that today. Acknowledge that you are a sinner and ask God to forgive you. Believe that Jesus is the Son of God and that God the Father raised him from the dead. Turn from your sinful ways, humble yourself before him, and surrender your life to him. Choose to follow him and ask him to take control of your life, and he will change you. He will make you a new creation. My prayer for each of you is that you make that decision today and accept the peace that Jesus is offering you. Now, more than ever before, we need to keep our eyes on Jesus. I mean, prophecies and the book of Revelation are unfolding right before our eyes. It's almost like, what chapter are we in today? So there's no better time than the present to put your trust in him. I thank you all so much for watching. I hope this video made you think a little more seriously and deeply about what our Savior has done for us. And remember, Friday is good because Sunday is coming. Thank you.